Welcome back. In the previous lecture, we learned about kets, which enable us to describe polarization qubits without referring to a particular binary alternative. Now, in this lecture, we will see how kets are naturally paired with partners that we call bras. In the previous lectures, we established that we have this formalism with kets for vertical, horizontal, diagonal, anti-diagonal, right circle, left circle of polarization. And that ket for vertical and horizontal, if we choose those as the fundamental ones, then we represent them by the columns 1, 0, and 0, 1. And then, say, the diagonal polarization is an equal weight superposition, a linear sum of vertical and horizontal polarization with the same weight, which is 1 over square root of 2 for normalization purposes. And so this sum of products we can also read as a product of a row of the fundamental kets, vertical and horizontal, and a column of the amplitudes, 1 over square root of 2 and 1 over square root of 2. And then for the anti-diagonal polarization, we have the column with amplitudes 1 over square root of 2 and negative 1 over square root of 2. And for right circular and left circular polarization, we have 1 and I divided by square root of 2 or 1 minus I divided by square root of 2. And for the general polarization ket, well, referring to the vertical horizontal states as a reference, we will have amplitudes alpha and beta. And then we can just write that this ket is represented by the column alpha and beta. So this is a numerical representation of this geometrical object that we call ket. However, I keep emphasizing that when we represent it by a column, we have to say what are the basis kets to which this refers. In this example, it's the vertical and the horizontal polarization. Let's recall what we wrote down at the end of the previous lecture, where we had the generic ket, and it began with that expression, vertical, horizontal, and amplitudes alpha, beta. But then that was also equal to diagonal and anti-diagonal. Alpha plus beta divided by square root of 2, alpha minus beta divided by square root of 2 for the amplitudes, with referring to these basis kets. And we also had, if we have right-handed and left-handed circular polarization, then these coefficients were given by alpha minus I beta divided by the square root of 2 and alpha plus I beta divided by square root of 2. So, if we begin with the alpha beta, how do we get this? Okay. But before we answer this question, let's see, from alpha beta, how do we extract the alpha? Well, we do that by multiplying this column with the row, which is 1, 0, and that picks out the amplitude alpha. And if we multiply the alpha beta column with the row 0, 1, that picks out the amplitude beta. Likewise, if we want to pick out alpha plus beta square root 2, we have the alpha beta, and then we multiply it with the row which has 1, 1 divided by square root 2. And that gives us alpha plus beta divided by square root 2. And we get alpha minus beta divided by square root 2 if we multiply with the row which has 1 and negative 1 and the square root 2 factor for normalization. And finally, now how do we pick out alpha minus I beta square root 2? Well, again, we have the column alpha beta, and now we multiply with the row 1 minus I divided by square root 2, and that gives us alpha minus I beta divided by square root of 2. And finally, to get alpha plus I beta divided by square root of 2. Well, we multiply with 1i, 1 over square root of 2. So for each case, for each of these amplitudes, there is a matching rho in this formalism that converts the alpha beta column that refers to vertical and horizontal to the coefficients of the columns that go with the other set of polarizations. So the clue is actually here. We can see it here better than everywhere else. Because if we remember what the right-handed circular polarization refers to, well, that goes with the column of 1i square root 2. Here we have the rho, 1 minus I divided by square root 2. So this rho of 1 minus I square root 2 is related to this column that we have here by taking the transpose and the complex conjugation. That's taking the Hermitian adjoint. So it's complex conjugation combined with taking the transpose matrix. So this is a matrix which is just a column. We take the transpose and it's just a single row. But we also take the complex conjugates of the matrix elements. So this I then becomes minus I. And likewise here, the 1 over square root 2, 1i, is the transposed complex conjugate of the column of the amplitudes for the left-handed circular polarization in the vertical horizontal basis. So now, the adjoint of that. So this then is the column represents the left circular polarized head, and now we take the adjoint. And so we need another kind of symbol that reflects the adjoint of a head, and that's what we call a bra. So this is a ket, but the adjoint of the ket. So you take the adjoint of a ket, you get a bra. Much like taking the adjoint of a column, you get a row, a corresponding row. So for each ket, by taking the adjoint, we have the corresponding bra. And so what will represent the bra that goes with vertical and horizontal polarization? Well, quite simple, right? So the bra that goes with vertical polarization, which is the adjoint of the bra of the ket that goes with vertical polarization, so this will be represented by the adjoint of this column, which is this row, 1, 0. And likewise, if we have the horizontal polarization, that will be represented by the 0, 1 row, and so forth. For the diagonal polarization, we have a bra that is represented by 1 over square root 2, 1, 1, the adjoint that we see here. And for the anti-diagonal polarization, we have 1 over square root of 2, 1 minus 1, which is just what we see here. Now, combining these things as they stand here, we can just notice that, say, this coefficient that goes with the diagonal polarization, we get it by taking the rho that represents the diagonal polarization bra, and here's the column that stands for the generic ket. So we have the bra for diagonal polarization multiplying the ket for the generic polarization, and this will give us the amplitude for the generic polarization with respect to the diagonal the diagonal polarization. So when I'm writing this product of a bra and a cat, well, the bra has a vertical line and the cat has a vertical line. We just write one vertical line, and this is called a bracket product or a bracket. And so you kind of can guess where this terminology of bras and cats comes from. So more generally, if you remember your linear algebra, what we have here is an inner product of the column alpha beta and the column 1, 1. Maybe I write a dot here for the inner product. And that is realized by taking the adjoint of this column, which is the 1 divided by square root of 2, 1, 1 row. And then we have an ordinary row times column product, and it gives us the alpha plus beta divided by square root of 2. So if we translate this now to the language of cats, then we have an inner product of two cats. Let me write this over here. We have an inner product of two cats. Say I quite generally now take cat number 1 and cat number 2. And the inner product of these two cats, well, that will just be the product of the bra 2 with the cat 1. Now we recognize one thing. If you take adjoints, so here we take an adjoint of a column and we get a row. If we take adjoint again, we get the adjoint of the row, and it goes back to this column, because if you transpose and take a complex conjugate and then you transpose again and take another complex conjugate, you go back to where you started. So here we have converted the bra 2 into the cat 2 into the bra 2, and we kept the cat 1. But we can also read this as the bra 2 and the bra 1 adjoint, because the adjoint of the bra 1 will be the cat 1. So here I have a product of two bras. So we also have an inner product of two bras. And whether I talk about the inner product of these two cats or the inner product of these two bras, we get the same bracket. Okay, this bracket is the number that we calculate, and we can calculate it by using the column representation for the bra and the row representation for the cat, as we had it in any of these examples, a column for the cat and a row for the bra in each of those products. And each of these products is really a bracket that we are evaluating. But we have now taken a major step, because we have recognized that this formalism that we are developing is actually a formalism of cats and bras related to each other by the adjoint operation. And there is a space of cats, a linear space of cats. We can multiply cats by numbers and add them to make new cats. Now, if you take the adjoint of this statement, you will find that you can multiply bras with numbers and add them up and get new bras. So there is a linear space for the cats, a linear space for the bras, and they are both endowed with an inner product. And this inner product actually relates the bra space to the cat space. In summary, for each cat, there is an adjoint bra. The linear space of the bras is fully analogous to the linear space of the cats. Both spaces are endowed with an inner product, which is given in terms of a product of a bra with a cat. And that gives us a complex number. We compute that by multiplying the row for the bra with the column for the cat. In the next lecture, we will explore more consequences of having this inner product.